Two weeks ago, I started looking at passages that have been misunderstood, and I'm particularly looking at passages relating to the law. Before we look at this morning, I just wanted to say something. Last night in our fellowship session, I said something, and I felt uneasy all last night. I didn't even sleep so well because it seems like what I said might have been misunderstood, and I'm because it rested on my mind, I feel like I need to further clarify what I mean, because I did say that as Christians we're not to concern ourselves about the minute details of our performance, about are we perfect in keeping the law, are we perfect in doing this or that, and I did say that those are not the important things, and it seems like I seemed to be saying that it doesn't matter if we sin. At least that is the way it seems to have been understood by some persons. So it bothered me because that is not at all my understanding of righteousness. I understand that when a person is in Christ, his life changes. Not only does he have a desire to do everything that pleases God, but he also has an inborn change in his nature that pushes him in that direction. So what did I mean, and why do I make this point? What I was trying to say is that when a person comes to Christ, what happens in his life thereafter is not his concern. It is Christ's concern. The Bible says that it is God who works in you, in Philippians somewhere. Philippians 2, I believe, or 3. It is God who works in you to will and to do of his good pleasure. In my experience, and I think many of us can testify to this, the more you think about sin and the more you try to fight sin, the more you will be defeated. I'm not going to debate about that. I have seen it enough and I've experienced it enough. The more you try to fight sin, the more you are going to be beaten. Because we cannot fight sin, and that is not our, that job was never given to us. Jesus said it this way: if you abide in me, you will bear much fruit. Without me, you can do nothing. In other words, what he's saying is that we have a job, and that job is to abide in Christ. The rest of it is not our business. It is not for me to obsess about becoming perfect. It's not for me to try to focus on how can I overcome the next sin. This kind of emphasis is counterproductive because it leads to more sin appearing in my life. Because once you start concentrating on the things I am doing, brothers and sisters, your attention becomes self-centered. I mean, it's not just a Christian principle, it's a psychological principle. You yourselves can tell. I mean, whenever you If some of us have the opportunity to counsel with people, talk to somebody who is having a lot of problems in his life and tell me what he focuses on. Talk to anybody who is having problems in his life and who is depressed and who might even be thinking of killing himself. You know what he will tell you? I will challenge you. What he will tell you or she will tell you is all about himself or herself. They will tell you about all your failures and how they've been trying and they just can't make it. That's what they will tell you. That is what kills people and makes it worse and worse. If you look at yourself, you will never find anything good. The central truth of the Christian faith is that we stop concerning ourselves about ourselves and turn our attention to Jesus Christ. Turn our attention to God in Jesus Christ. Rejoice in him, fill ourselves with him, get to know him better, absorb ourselves in his beauty. Your life will change and you won't even recognize it. So this is what I mean. This is what I was really trying to say. I'm really saying that our understanding of the sin problem and of what it means to be a sinner is not always the way God sees things. Having said that, I will also add something. I was in a discussion with a brother this morning, and I thought it was important to make this point, and I noticed when I made the point, it changed the discussion a little bit. And I'm going to say it again because of that. In Christianity, in Christian understanding, there are two different ideas about sin. Two ideas. The first idea is an idea that is an extension of the Old Testament. And that first idea is that sin has to do with your behavior, your individual actions. Sin is an action whereby you transgress the law. Whether in your actions or in your thoughts or in your intents and motives, sin has to do with your performance. The greater, what I consider the greater understanding, the second understanding is that sin has to do with your relationship with God. In other words, sin in the second sense means that you're in a state where you are cut off from God. That is sin. That is to be in a state of sin. And when a person is in this condition, Jesus says of this person, Jesus says this, it's Jesus' words, whosoever commits sin is the servant of sin. John 8 and verse 34. And what he means by this is that you are committing an action of sin. Why? Because you're a servant of the master called sin. You see the two ideas of sin there. Sin is your action, and the action of sin is caused because you have a master named sin. And that master named sin is you running your life. God is not, you are not joined to God, you are running your life. And so this inward thing called sin is mastering you. Paul also speaks about it when he says, the good that I want to do, I don't do. The evil that I don't want to do, I find myself doing it. It is no more I who am doing it. It is sin that is living in me. Nobody who is a student of the Bible can deny these two concepts. They are in the Bible very plain. I'm not looking at the verses now, but you know they are there, right? So, in this context, I will ask you, can a Christian commit sin? Can a Christian commit sin? Well, if you are using the first definition, transgression of the law, having a wrong thought, having a fleeting, anybody can commit sin, and does, and even, and all the Christians I know do commit sin in that sense. They do not do it habitually. It's no longer their habit or their lifestyle, but sometimes it creeps in. You all know this is the truth. If you can find somebody that it never happens to, I will know that I'll have to change my word. Either that or you find me a liar. But in the second understanding of sin, can a Christian commit sin in the second understanding? No, John says, he that is born of God does not commit sin, and he cannot sin. It means that you cannot live in the state of separation from God. It's impossible. You can't commit sin in that sense, if you're a Christian. So all of us in this sense who are genuine Christians have put away sin, and we are no longer sinners, and we no longer commit sin in the second understanding. And this is what Paul talks about in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 26. Here's what he says. He says, if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of truth, there is no more sacrifice for sin. If you sin after you have received Christ, you are lost forever. That is what the Bible says. And the only way you can understand this is if you look at the second. If you look at the second meaning, then it's clear. If you're dealing with the first meaning of sin, which in my opinion, this is the lesser definition. It's the old covenant definition. It still applies. If you do wrong, somebody says you committed sin. Fine, you understand what the person is saying. But this committing of sin in this sense, if this stumbling, I call it stumbling, if this causes a person to be lost, all of us are lost. The only way you can hope for salvation is if you happen to say, I'm sorry, quickly enough. And you have to keep saying, I'm sorry, every day. Otherwise, you're lost. And every day, you're lost and you're saved. You're lost and you're saved. Over and over, like a rabbit jumping in and out of a hole. It's kind of ridiculous. Salvation puts me in a place of security. I leave sin behind. I put it away. My condition of living without God is over. I'm no longer living in sin. I'm living now in righteousness because Jesus Christ is my life. And if I happen to stumble, it's not my will and it's not my lifestyle, but it can happen. And that is sin on the lower level. On the greater level, I do not commit sin. I do not turn my back on God. I do not let him out of my life. Even if I stumble, I'm hanging on to him. So Christians, do not sin, because if you sin, you're lost forever. So I hope that this further clarifies what I'm trying to say. At the end of the presentation this morning, I will leave a little time for questions, so that if there are any questions relating to this that I just said, or anything else, we can have a little time to discuss it, all right? So, and you know, it's not something I'm making up. It's there in the Bible very clearly. And if I quoted the verses and you want to look at the verses after the session, just ask me. Let's look at the verses together, because we don't want to build our doctrines on human speculation. But it's Bible. It's in the Bible, and you can't explain these Bible verses any other way. This one in Hebrews chapter 10, for example, if we sin willfully after we receive the knowledge of the truth, there is no more sacrifice for sin. How does anybody explain that if you think sin is just your actions and your activities? I've never met a Christian who never sinned where his will was involved after he became a Christian. Everyone that I know, even the most holy and the most pious, they became Christians and then they slipped back at times. What, we're all lost? No, there's another explanation, and that's what I am saying. So please, at the end of the session, if there are any questions, please go ahead. You wanted to say something?
Brother David?
Yes, Travco.
Can you quote just one from 1 John chapter 3 and verses 8?
Let me just read it quickly, since you asked for me to just do that. 1 John 3 and verse 8. And it says, he that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Yeah, that's a good one to Dravko, because, you know, if you don't understand this greater understanding of sin, then every one of us would be of the devil.
Yes, we are not from devil.
Absolutely. And I don't intend to even transgress even that first understanding of sin. I don't intend to do it. This morning I was talking to God, and I was looking back over my life, and I was thinking, what are the transgressions that I can number that I did this week? And before God, I could think of two. One of them is that I was not, I could help my wife some more. I could help my wife some more. That's one of the things that I numbered as among the two transgressions that I can think of. And, you know, I was thinking, well, if you're going to measure me like that, I could say I'm doing well in keeping the law. But I was just talking to God and doing it, because these thoughts were in my head, and I realized that that is not what I want. That is not what I want. I have something better than that. What I am after takes me above and beyond that, right? I'm in fellowship with God, and that is what I'm really focused on. But just for argument's sake, I tried to do this and look at my life this week. And, you know, if I were going to measure myself that way, I could feel pretty pleased with myself, right? Maybe somebody else could look and they would find other things, but that's what I could think of. And so it's not that I am saying be comfortable with living lives of transgression. Absolutely not. No Christian is comfortable when he comes short of the glory of God. No Christian. But at the same time, we do not overcome by focusing on those things. Our attention should be elsewhere. All right, so last 2 weeks I was looking at passages that are misunderstood, and I want to just complete that set this week. I'm going to the third set of passages, and these passages are particularly relating to the law. Last week we looked at the one where Paul says, not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. That was Romans 2 and verse 13. Last week we looked at that. And the previous week we looked at Matthew chapter 5, where it says that till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law. We looked at those passages. Now this week we're going to look at some verses that focus on the commandments. And the reason we're doing this is because people get the impression that we're saying that the commandments are irrelevant, they're abolished, and you don't need to walk in harmony. They say you don't need to keep the commandments. They say we are saying you don't need to keep the commandments. And that's a technical statement. Okay, I'm maybe going to comment on it as well. But what they say is that here are verses in the Bible that say you must keep the commandments. Here are verses. And I would say, how do we relate to those verses? How would I respond to those verses? Now, in my opinion, the word keep is a tricky word. When somebody asks me, do you keep the commandments? I have a hard time answering them in a simple way. I have a hard time. But I'm going to ask a question that all of us is encouraged to consider. I'm going to encourage you to consider this question. And this question will explain why it is hard for me to answer the question. Here's a question. Does God keep the commandments? I'd be interested in somebody just unmuting yourself and giving me an answer. Does God keep the commandments?
He lives the commandments. He doesn't keep them.
All right. Thank you, Brother Joseph. Thank you. I like the way you put it. And that is why I'm saying the question is hard for me to answer, because the person who asks the question, do you keep the commandments? He has a certain concept in his mind. And I have a different concept. I end up being in harmony with the commandments, but I'm not subject to the commandments. I'm not subject to the commandments. The person who is keeping the commandments is the person who has an obligation and is subject to it. The question, does God keep the commandments? That's why I ask you the question, because God does not keep the commandments. You keep what has authority over you in that sense. You keep what has authority over you. The commandments do not have authority over God. God does not keep the commandments. When we become absorbed in Christ, when we are in Christ, we operate on the same principle from which God operates, because it is God in you fulfilling his purposes. So we walk in harmony with the commandments, not because we are absorbed with the commandments, and not because we are focused on the commandments, and not because we are responding to the commandments, but because God is living his holy life within us. Now I hope that this is simple and is clear to everyone. If it's not clear, then you know you could stop me at this point if it's not clear. So when I look at these statements in the Bible about the commandments, it's technical when you are in a discussion, because you know I'm in harmony with this. But what they want to push on you is that you must be subject to this. You are subject to this. That is what, and so you can't answer the question easily, because half of it is true and half of it is not true. Does it make a difference? It makes a huge difference. It makes a huge difference, because the person who is focused on the law must relate the law to himself. It comes back again to being self-absorbed. Whereas the person who forgets about the law and forgets about sin and focuses on Christ is focused in the right way, and the results appear in his life, even though it does not matter to him. This is the freedom of Christianity. It's the freedom. It's where Jesus says, you shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free. I am the truth. I am the life. That is how freedom comes into the Christian life. You don't become free by becoming obsessed. I mean, a soldier keeps the rules, right? A soldier should keep the rules. They march in order. They get up at a certain time. They clean their boots. They do all the duties. It doesn't mean that they are free. It simply means that they are performing like robots. They are trained to be robotic in the way they do things. It doesn't mean they are happy in what they are doing. It simply means that they have been trained to respond a certain way. That's not Christianity. Christianity is a person living his life freely, without stress and without fuss, and being joyful and happy and free in that living. And things fall into place because you are simply being what you are. So I'm going to share my Bible at this time and go straight to those verses that talk about the commandments. This is the last week that I'm really looking at these these verses, misunderstood verses. All right, so first of all, let me explain something at the beginning. I know that most of us are aware of this, but I still feel the need to repeat it. The Old Testament is very much focused on keeping the law. The keeping of the law is the emphasis of Old Testament religion. To be accepted of God and to be considered one of God's people, you had to keep the commandments. It says very clearly that it shall be our righteousness in Deuteronomy 6 and verse 24. It says it will be our righteousness if we keep all these commandments. I think it's verse 24 of Deuteronomy 6. Yeah. It shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments. All right. So this is old covenant religion. We do these commandments and it's our righteousness. It's the way we are right. It's the way we become right. But we all know that in the New Testament, there is a radical change in what the Bible is saying because we are under a different covenant. And so in this new covenant, it says in Romans 10 and verse 4, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. In other words, this question of righteousness is no longer by the law. It's now by Christ. Christ has brought this way of righteousness through the law to an end. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. And in case you think I am misinterpreting it, we go down a little bit lower. The next verse, and it says, for Moses describes the righteousness which is of the law. And what does he say? What does Moses say? He says that the man which does these things shall live by them. That's what Moses says. That's what the Old Testament says. But the righteousness which is of faith speaks in this way, on this wise. Do not say in your heart, who shall go into heaven? That is to bring Christ down from above. Or who shall descend into the deep? That is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? What does righteousness of faith say? The word is near you, even in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in the heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. Man believeth unto righteousness. And with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So this is righteousness by faith, whereas the righteousness which is of the law speaks of the things you do. The man who does these things shall live by them. The righteousness of faith says that the man who believes these things. Now, I went to these verses because I want to point out the difference. And at the same time, I want to say two things that I want us to remember. In the New Testament, in the age of the New Testament, the Bible of the church was the Old Testament. The scriptures that the apostles preached from was the Old Testament. So the language of the Old Testament is in the New Testament. The language of the Old Testament is there. The pictures and the images are there. And what we have to do many times is to take the New Testament understanding and apply to those words. Now, I hope you can understand this. Most of us who are here, we are mature enough in the gospel that we can understand what I'm saying. And if you don't, then bear it in mind and we'll discuss it later on in this discussion. So with this in mind, I want to go to some of the main verses that are often used to support the idea of us still being under the law and still being obligated to the law, which are found in the New Testament. Now, I want to go first of all to a favorite one, Revelation 11 and verse 19. It says, "And the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament. And there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail." Now, of course, this is indisputable. This is indisputable to some people. It says the temple was opened in heaven, and we see there the Ark of the Covenant. And we know very well that the Ark of the Testament was designed specifically to contain the Ten Commandments. So here we find it triumphantly said that you see clearly. This is at the time just before the coming of Jesus. If you read the book of Revelation, it's Revelation 11 and verse 19. Just before the coming of Jesus, this is what happens. And it is said, therefore, that we can see clearly that God is pointing us to the Ten Commandments. Because according to the theology of Seventh-day Adventism, the Ten Commandments are the center of our work, and it should be at the center of our teaching. This is what Adventists say, that Jesus is the center of our preaching. But practically speaking, it is the law that is at the center of Adventist theology. You all know, because you're all a part of it. Now it says that there's a temple in heaven, and the Ark of the Covenant is in heaven. So I want to go back a little bit further, and I want to show you something. Revelation 8 and verse 3. "And another angel came and stood at the altar." Where is this? This is in heaven. "Stood at the altar in heaven, having a golden censer in heaven. And there's given unto him much incense in heaven, upon the golden altar which is before the throne." So there's a censer, there's a golden altar, there's an Ark of the Testament, there's a temple. Let's look at somewhere else. Let's look at chapter 5. It says, "And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain." So you have a slain lamb. You have an altar. You have a censer. You have incense. You have the Ark of the Covenant. Now, here's what I would say to you. If you view one of these things as being literal, then if you are consistent, and if you have any sense, let me be blunt. If you are consistent, then everything else must be literal. If the Ark is literal, then the censer must be literal, and the altar must be literal. And the incense must be literal, and the slain lamb must be literal. If I'm not making sense, stop me. But I believe in consistency. God is not confused, and God is not confusing us. God is consistent. However you apply one of these things, you have to apply the rest of it. So let's go first of all to the lamb, because that's the first symbol we see. We also see seven candlesticks, okay? And everything that we have an interpretation for, we know it is symbolic. The seven candlesticks are not literal candlesticks. They are said to be the seven churches. One place they are said to be the seven spirits of God. The slain lamb is not a literal lamb. It's Jesus Christ. What about the incense? Is there an angel in heaven burning incense before God so that he can smell the incense? Ridiculous and stupid. We understand that it means something else. It is symbolizing the righteousness of Christ being offered with the prayers of the saints. You cannot see righteousness and you cannot see prayers, and yet you have a censer and you have incense. It's symbolic, brothers and sisters. It's symbolic, guys. It's symbolic. So what about the Ark of the Covenant in heaven? Why suddenly does this become literal? A literal box in heaven with two stone tables with 10 statements written on it. It's, please forgive me for being blunt, it's ridiculous, it's simplistic, and I'm being very polite when I use these words. What do we do with this David, argument? Yes,
Brother David. Let me tell you something. To be blunt, Seventh-day Adventists have replaced Christ with the law, and they can see nothing else. Everything is interpreted in the light of the law.
I agree.
Consequently, they see everything, as you pointed out there, as literal. They will try to escape and to use some of it as, okay, this is spiritual, but this is literal. Nonsense. They don't want to face the facts that they have replaced Christ with the law. And nothing you say to them make any sense anymore. They are so steep into legalism that everything becomes a fraud.
Right. So you know, I believe that there are other groups of Christians as well, but unfortunately most of us here can understand it better from the perspective of Adventism because that is our background. So I agree with you there, Brother Arthur. So when you see the Ark of the Covenant, obviously, brothers and sisters, you have to apply it according to the New Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant in the box in that sanctuary represented the New Covenant. In the New Covenant, you translate it. In the New Covenant, are we dealing with 10 with 2 tables of stone? No, we are dealing with God's character implanted in his people. This is a true law of God. This is a true covenant that God makes with his people. He writes his law, or he puts his nature in us. He puts his spirit in us and so gives us his own nature. This is the New Covenant. So when you see in the book of Revelation, the Ark of the Covenant is open in heaven, God is pointing us to the New Covenant. He's pointing us to the completion of the process of Christ being reproduced in his people. We don't go back legalistically and suddenly this becomes 2 tables of stone inside a box in heaven. No, we apply the New Testament principles because this is how God has done it consistently in the book of Revelation and in the New Testament for that matter. Once we understand this principle, brothers and sisters, we can begin to look at the other statements about the commandments in the book of Revelation. For example, in Revelation 12 and verse 17, it says, "And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ." Now, unfortunately, there are some people, anytime it mentions the commandments of God, they instantly think of 10 statements, instantly. In the New Covenant, in the New Testament, there is something else that God emphasizes far more than 10 commandments, far more. And we should logically look at the New Covenant when we see the book of Revelation. God's people, the remnant of the seed, they keep the commandments of God. Let me just go to one place in particular just to respond to this statement. 1 John chapter 3. Now remember that John wrote the book of Revelation. And John wrote the book of St. John. And John wrote 1st and 2nd and 3rd John. Those are his 5 books in the Bible. And in Revelation, we are looking at a book written by John. Here's what John says in 1 John chapter 3. He says in verse 22, "And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight." John likes to talk about the commandments. I'm going to come back to this verse, but let me just go quickly to chapter 2 and read a verse here. It says in verse 3 and 4, "And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments." Notice he uses the word keep. I'm not going to inquire about it. I'm saying they use the language of the Old Covenant many times. We know that we know him if we keep his commandments. "He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him." In other words, those who know God, they will walk in harmony with the commandments of God. John says keep, no problem. But let's go back to that verse in chapter 3. Let's go back to chapter 3. See what he says. Whatsoever we ask, verse 22, we receive of him because we keep his commandments. So there you see, John is talking about the commandments in the same way. And do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Now, immediately continues. He does not miss a verse. In the next verse, he says, and this is his commandment. He's explaining what he's talking about. This is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment.
Therefore, to keep the commandment, Brother David, to keep the commandment really is to believe in all that Jesus has said.
Absolutely. When John and these New Testament writers speak about keeping the commandments, they're focusing specifically on believing in Jesus, and as an outgrowth of this, love one another. And we know that love encompasses all of the Ten Commandments. But anyway, the emphasis is not on legalistically observing 10 rules. It's bigger and broader, and it begins, first of all, the commandment of God. The first commandment is to believe on the name of the Son, Jesus Christ. When the Jews asked Jesus, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Jesus says, this is the work of God, that we believe on the one that he has sent. So it's clear that in the New Testament concept, keeping the commandments of God primarily has to do with our relationship to Jesus Christ. And secondly, in our love for each other. It's not focusing on 10 statements. And I'm making this point because of the obsession that people have with the 10 rules. We need to translate our religion into new covenant religion. Does this mean that the 10 rules were bad? No, I never said this. Does it mean that the 10 rules are no longer principles of good? How could I say this? Does it mean that we Christians walk in out of harmony with the 10 rules? No. We are in harmony with those 10 rules. That's why we are here today, keeping the Sabbath. That's why we don't kill, we don't steal, we don't lie, we don't commit adultery. We are in harmony with the 10 rules. But the Christian life is not focused on the 10 rules. Those 10 rules and walking with them is incidental to Christianity. They're just a byproduct of Christianity. Mr. Dan, I wonder if you're going to say something, because hey,
Brother,
Martin,
I think Sutherland is first.
Oh, Wayne, you wanted to say something?
Yes, I just wanted to ask, in light of the fact that whenever you hear the word commandment, the default thought is Exodus 20. Is there a word I could use to substitute commandment, but yet still bring across the same meaning? You know, so as I say, keep my commandment, keep something else, you know, another way.
I suppose it's hard. I mean, you could make a distinction by referring to the 10 as the Decalogue, as some people do. The Decalogue means the 10 statements, but Jesus did leave some instructions with his disciples. Right? Do these things in remembrance of me. This is my commandment, that you love one another. He says commandment, so it's kind of like, you know, you could feel around and say that Jesus' principles, but if we had lived in the days of the apostles, we would have understood automatically. But because we live in an age and in an atmosphere where everybody is focused on the Decalogue, it becomes confusing. So maybe the simplest thing we can do is explain as we go along.
How about the commandments being the promises? How about the promises?
Keep my words.
John 13:34, a new commandment I give you, love one another.
Right. And as I said, the New Testament is full of this idea of the new principle. Paul himself says, all of these commandments, if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this word, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. They all focus on the principle instead of the detail. So we really have to be a bit hard-headed to be able to miss the point. So anyway, the next thing I want to look at Revelation 22 and verse 14.
Before you go there.
Sister Diane is
I was thinking in 1 John 2:6, he says something that's important. Even though he's talking about keeping the commandments, he puts in this one caveat, which I think helps to explain the rest. And it's just, he's talking about knowing him if you don't, but look what he says here. He that saith he abideth in him, himself also to walk, even as he walked. So now the emphasis, here's the connection. The emphasis is abiding. And therefore, in your abiding, you're going to walk the way he walked, because he's living in you. So now if he continues on about commandment keeping, then it's obvious that it's not you out setting out to establish your own righteousness. It is you abiding in Christ and focusing in on, and your focus is him and not the law. And your focus is the connection with him. And I was thinking also about the wilderness when they were bitten, you know. Now their situation was dire because they were full of problems. I mean, they were stung with the venom and they were going to die. The remedy was not to continue to look and focus in on their problem, which those who did die. Their focus was to look to him and live. And so that has to be our focus, to look to him in order to live. And another thing, that if only scripture, there was no scripture except the Old Testament. The Torah was all they had. So if they're teaching people, they're teaching them from the scriptures. And that language in the scriptures, now they're living in a new dispensation. It had, because the new covenant had come. When Paul and them were teaching, that new covenant was established, but the only teaching in scripture they got is the Old Testament. And yes. So they still have to use that language in order to teach the new way, because Jesus said that I am that way, I am the way. So for them to teach it, they got to teach it from the scriptures. They didn't have what we have now, the new in the scriptures, right?
And the classical example that I love to use is where the New Testament says and emphasizes the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you from sin. The blood of Jesus does not cleanse you from sin.
It's a life.
It's the life of Jesus, but they are using the language of the law. If the blood cleanses you from sin, let me see it. Show it to me. Show me the red liquid. Show me the plasma and the corpuscles. Blood does not cleanse from sin, but they are preaching from the old covenant and they use that language. And this is all over the New Testament. The language of the old covenant, you have to translate it. And that is where, if you ask me, the greatest problem in Christendom and in Adventism, it's the problem of being able to translate the Old Testament meaning into the New Testament realities. That's the greatest problem.
Avid?
Yeah, man.
Somebody made a comment. Marilyn said that Brother David already said, consider the word keep in reference to the law. So I'm not sure if that is something that needs to be. So commandments is okay, but explain the word keep. Which he explained, keep in reference to the law. She said, you just said that.
Yeah, what I would say is that many times, I myself and many Christians, we use the language of what is written, because the language is convenient. But that is why sometimes we have to stop and explain certain things. Like when you talked about keep, I explained why. For me, the word keep is a tricky word, even though I use it, and I probably just used it. But when I use it, and if I just use it, then you understand it's in the context of my earlier explanation. And it's something we can't get away from. You know, like I will say, this evening the sun will set at 6:30 or whenever. The sun does not set. The sun does not set. The world rotates. All right, that's what I believe. I know some people don't believe that. All right. Some people believe that the world is flat. But anyway, in any case, even the flat earthers, they don't believe the sun sets. They believe it kind of moves about in the sky. So nobody believes that the sun really sets. But we use a language. The same thing happens when we are dealing with the Bible. We say, keep the commandments. We say, the blood of Jesus cleanses sin. We use the words, but this is why sometimes we have to stop and break it down and explain what these things really mean. because otherwise people only have vague ideas. So when I say keep, we walk in harmony with the will of the Lord. Yes, there are some things that we learn and we do them. Like today we might say, we are keeping the Sabbath. But the idea of keeping the Sabbath really carries with it a legal obligation. It's a legal necessity. We have been instructed to do it, and therefore we do it. This is what keeping implies. In this sense, I am not keeping the Sabbath. I'm not keeping the Sabbath in this sense. What I am really doing is, God who says, listen, I'm going to make an opportunity for us to spend some time together. The opportunity is there. Do I want to be a part of it or don't I want to be a part of it? Do I value what I'm getting or don't I value it? It's my option. I choose to be involved in this. And in this sense, I'm keeping the Sabbath. But I'm not keeping the Sabbath in the legal understanding where I have an obligation. I'm doing it out of my free love and voluntary will because my nature pushes me in this direction, not because it is demanded of me. So that's the kind of distinction I'm really trying to make. Now, let me quickly just look at a couple of other verses, and then I'm going to stop so I can leave some time for questions. Revelation 22 and verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have a right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. If you take this literally, it's one of the most legalistic verses in the Bible. But then again, it's Revelation. Revelation is written in the language of the Old Covenant. It says, those that do his commandments, they have right to the tree of life. It's gaining by doing. Even if you say it's the new commandment that we love one another, it's still righteousness by works. There are two ways I can explain this. I could say, number one, you need to consider what does this mean in the new covenant, and you need to apply the new covenant understanding. But there's another way. I'm going to show you something, right? I love the King James Version of the Bible, but I'm going to go to about five different versions. I'm going to the New American Standard Bible, to the same verse. It says, blessed are they that wash their robes, so that they may have a right to the tree of life. The NIV says, blessed are those who wash their robes. The World English Bible says, okay, this one says commandments. Blessed are those who do his commandments. The New English Translation, blessed are those who wash their robes. The English Standard Version, blessed are those who wash their robes. And so on, okay? If you give me a choice, if I have to choose, being somebody who understands the gospel, I will go with blessed are those who wash their robes. Because keeping the commandments cannot give you right to the tree of life. It cannot. Unless you are completely, totally wrong about the gospel. Your right to salvation, your right to eternity, your right to the tree of life is the blood of Jesus Christ, is the life of Jesus Christ, is the gift of grace in Jesus Christ. That's your only right. You could keep the commandments until you are blue in the face. It will never give you right to the tree of life. So I like those translations in this verse that say, blessed are those who wash their robes in the blood of the Lamb. I will go with that translation. All right, so that's my response to this verse. And I would even say that even if you were to leave it there, the most it could be saying is that we need to translate it to the New Testament understanding. Right? Now, the last verse I want to look at is something we are familiar with because we have been through this several times, but I'm going to go to it again because it's such a
Brother David.
Yes, Brother Peter.
Yeah. The translations that you used a while ago, I like it too, but someone would ask, what does it mean to wash your robe in the blood of Christ?
Later on in Revelation, it talks about two groups of people. in Revelation chapter 6, well, that is earlier on, Revelation chapter 6, it says that the souls under the altar were given white robes. In Revelation 7, it says of the 144,000, they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. In both cases, as far as I'm concerned, it's talking about perfecting your character. Not your qualification for salvation, but the perfecting of your character. So,
in the life of Christ.
In the life of Christ.
Well,
in the life of
one Christ. One could argue that if you are washing your robe, it is you who are doing it. And that would mean salvation by works.
Yeah. I would put it down to terminology. Because when it says you wash your robe, how do you do that practically? That's the question. And once you come to the question, you see that it cannot mean you. What you do, you submit yourself to the washing machine. That's how you wash your robe, right? It's like you could say, I washed my clothes this morning, but what you did, it wasn't you, it was a washing machine who did it. But you cooperated with the machine, so you could say you did it. So that's how I would look at that statement.
Anything else you have to boast? If it were anything else other than the life of Christ, we would have something to boast.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And those who boast come to him and say, look what I did. And they can count what they did. They said, listen, I kept this many Sabbaths. I gave out this many tracts. I did this many Bible. I mean, they have something to boast. And what does he say? I never knew you.
Yes,
what? Because they were never connected. They were about doing their own righteousness.
The Pharisees and the publican.
Right. So the last passage we look at is Isaiah 66. And just because it's so popular, I'll go back to it again. I'm going to take one of these sessions, and I just want to look at how we interpret Old Testament prophecies as well. Prophecy. But anyway, it says in verse 23 of Isaiah 66, and it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord. Adventists love to use this. Sabbath keepers love to use this verse. Feast keepers love to use this verse. And this is another illustration of the danger of proof texting, where you pick up a verse in isolation and read it. This verse, of course, they wouldn't mind reading verse 22, because it says, "For as the new heavens and the new earth which I will make shall remain before me, saith the Lord, so shall your seed and your name remain. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord." What they will not do is continue till verse 24. For verse 24 says, "And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me. For their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched. And they shall be an abhorring unto all flesh." And at this point, I'd like to say, what a pleasant Sabbath pastime. What a pleasant Sabbath walk you will have, right? On Sabbaths, you go out to look upon people being eaten by worms and burning in a fire that cannot be quenched. What a wonderful, pleasant Sabbath activity. If you are silly enough to take this passage literally, which clearly some people do, but they stop at verse 23. Because the truth is, the whole thing is figurative. The whole thing is figurative. What God is doing, he's talking to the Jews, and he's talking about the new world, the new earth. But what he's doing, he is giving them an idea of what they consider to be perfect. Not the truth about the new world that is to come, the new earth. It's the truth about what they perceive to be paradise. When I was a little boy, and I thought of heaven, I thought of clouds, I thought of floating around on clouds. Right? And at that time, my thinking changed, and I thought we were going to be drinking milk and honey. Because those are words that are in the Bible. Then another time I thought that we're all going to be farmers, because it says we're going to plant vineyards and we're going to build houses. So we are going to be carpenters and farmers. the truth is, God is giving us pictures from the Hebrew lifestyle. And he's picturing what they considered to be the perfect life. Their perfect life was where you planted your vineyard and the Midianites didn't come and reap it. You built your houses and the Babylonians didn't come and burn it down. And you kept your Sabbaths and you kept your new moons. And everything that was bad was thrown on the garbage heap where there were worms eating dead bodies and the fire was never going out. That was their idea of the perfect system. Everything bad was dumped in the fire and was burned. And they kept their feasts and their new moons and they planted their vines and everything was perfect. That was their idea of heaven. And the prophecies of the Old Testament are given to us in that context. So you can't use this verse, even though I believe that the Sabbath was made for man. And I believe we'll be enjoying the Sabbath in the new earth. I believe this. But if you use this verse to prove it, you need to also agree with those people who use this verse to support keeping new moons and feast days. And you need to give them this verse to support everlasting hell and worms never dying and fire never going out. We have to be consistent. So anyway, this is how I would respond to some of these verses, brothers and sisters. And if you have been listening, I know you have been, you understand that in no way have I been trying to say that the Sabbath and the law are irrelevant. In no way have I been saying that these things are abolished from our lives. My point has been, and I hope you understand, that in the new system, God does not govern us by rules. He governs us by putting his spirit in our hearts. And from this new heart, our harmony and cooperation with his will, it flows naturally. One last example, and then I'll pause. You know, my children are all grown. One of the blessings I got because of homeschooling them. I think it's homeschooling, and I think it's something else. I think I was blessed. Okay, in many ways, my children are not in as advantageous a position as some other children. But I'll tell you one thing that I appreciate. Until today, all of them, they respect my opinion. All of them, my eldest to my youngest, some of them are in the chat right now, they respect my opinion. Not many fathers have that privilege. Not many fathers have that blessing. And so I don't have to command my children to do anything. I don't have to order them to do anything. I wouldn't even try to do it. But if they know that I want something, I can tell you, all of them will bend over backwards to do it. I don't need to command them. My children are in the chat, some of them, and they can testify. If they know that I want something, they will bend over backwards to do it. Even as I'm saying it, I'm just thinking about it and realizing it is true. And I'm realizing I am a blessed parent. I'm a blessed parent. So it helps me to understand God. God doesn't need to command me or you to do anything. Why would he? The only thing we need to know is that this will please my Father. That's how we live, brothers and sisters. That's how we live as Christians. We don't need the obligations. That is for the unrighteous and those who don't know him. So we are truly free to be ourselves and still to serve him. So I'm going to stop here, and I think I might have time for one song, but we are going to be blessed. We have a special privilege today, and we are going to have that privilege before I allow you your questions. But a Cliff is going to sing for us. So I'm going to, Cliff, if you are listening, which you should be, please go right ahead. Turn on your mic.
All right, unmuted. You want to mute everyone, David? Mute everyone and unmute myself. There we go. All right, happy Sabbath, family. I'm sure we are all here today because of our deep love for Jesus. But, you know, our experience, our journey, our road here to where we are all differing, are all different. And the song I want to share with you is my journey. It is how I got here. And if you know this song, you know, just kind of sing along, you know, in your own homes, but, you know, keep your mics muted because of the network delay. I would love to be there to, you know, to sing with you, but, you know, we're all here on this delayed network. But, you know, I would not be here today if I would be lost if I did not have God's amazing grace. That's what I want to share with you today. I mean, just listen to these words. Time measured out my days. Life just carried me along. But in my soul I yearn to follow God. And I knew I'd never be that strong. I looked hard at this world to see how heaven can be gained. Just to end where I began, where all the human efforts were all in vain. But were it not for grace, I could tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation known to me. I didn't know how that would go. The many battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to this friend who took my place and ran a course I could not even start. And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so all would not be lost. But were it not for grace, I will tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, my salvation up to me. And I know how that would go. The many battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. Forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace, my God's grace.
Amen. Thank you, Cliff. Thank you very much.
Amen. Amen. Very nice. Amen.
The platform is not the best for music, but we really appreciate it and we're able to hear pretty good. Now, before I stop the recording, I'm going to ask, my time is up. If there is one question, I will take it. I intended to have a little question and answer, but our time is up and I don't want to intrude too much on Howard's time. So I could take one question if there's any question concerning what we discussed. If there's no question and something comes up, we can look at it this evening, all right? I want to give Howard enough time. Somebody has a quick question? All right.
Brother David.
So yes.
I just wanted to look at the concordance. Verse 30 and give me explanation.
All right, I'll do that as quickly as I can. And then I'll hand over to Brother Howard. 2 Corinthians 3 and verse 13 says, All right, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. The word abolished here, I think, is what Brother Peter wants to focus on. And the technicality here is that we ask, what is abolished? What was abolished? What is abolished is the old covenant. What is abolished is a system of relating to God through the law. This is a principle of the old covenant, and that has been abolished. The center of that covenant was the Ten Commandments, and that covenant has been abolished. And in this sense, the commandments have been abolished. In this sense, right? So, as a part of our relationship with God, they have been abolished. However, have they been abolished as an expression of right and wrong? Absolutely not, because it is still true, thou shalt not kill. That is still true. It is still true that you shouldn't steal. So in this sense, the commandments are not abolished. They are still an expression of right and wrong. But as a factor in the relationship with God, they and their covenant has been abolished. So that's my response, Brother Peter. All right, so...
Brother David, when you say abolish in the terms of the believer, because it's still necessary to bring others to Christ, there are still people that are out there that are not in Christ that have to be brought to Christ. And to them, he's a schoolmaster.
It can still serve that purpose. I agree. It can still serve that purpose. I say it can still serve that purpose rather than saying it is still there for that purpose. And there's a reason I make that distinction too, but I won't. The mic is very noisy for some reason. But anyway, I could discuss my reason for being so technical another time, but it will take some time if I go into it here now.
And I get it, because when you read Galatians, and this was a long time ago, and it was a very difficult study for me, and I had to go, I think it was Jones or Wagner, I don't know, to help with that understanding of that book. And when you understand it, it was not only the system of the Torah, it was also the Ten Commandment law. It was the Decalogue that was also done in Galatians. It's the two laws that were done. So I don't know, most people don't see that and understand that it was two laws in Galatians that was nailed to the cross. I thought that was interesting.
Right, because they don't understand what it means to be under the law. But